Mary Kent, and it's a great privilege to be back here at First Baptist Church, where some of us got started 50 years ago, and it's a privilege to get to play and sing a song for you this morning as a part of this Palm Sunday celebration that we learned right here with an ensemble group in our youth those years ago. So, and I'd like to thank my mom again. She got me started playing the piano when I was a little bitty guy, and I still love it. So it's a great joy to be with you. And my wife Mary grew up here as well. Many of you know her, but she was not able to travel with me this trip. But thanks for the opportunity and privilege to be with you this morning. The song from way back in the Old Testament. I understand you've been reading in Exodus in these days. Oh, Moses, way back there in the wilderness, saw some smoke. Came to the bush, and the bush was burning. God said, take off your shoes, Moses. You're on holy ground. Moses, I'm calling you to be my man. Moses, way down in Egypt's land. Moses, I'm calling you to work for me. Moses, I'm calling you to set my people free. Not me, Lord. Don't you know I can't talk so good? I stutter all the time. Do you know my brother Aaron? Well, he can sing like an angel. Talk like a preacher, not me, Lord. And another thing, how will they know that I've been here with you? How will they know what you've sent me to do? Don't you know in Egypt they want little Moses' head? Don't you know in Egypt they want little Moses dead? Don't you know they'll never hear a single word I'll say? Maybe you'd better get your dirty work done another way. Not me, Lord. Please.
What's that in your hand, Moses?
It's just a rod.
Well, I said, throw it down, Moses.
Do you mean like on the ground?
Yes, I said, throw it down, Moses.
Lord, don't take my rod away from me. Don't you know it's my only security? Don't you know when you've lived here all alone, a man gotta have something he can call his own. Not me, Lord.
Throw it down, Moses.
But Lord, I
throw it down, Moses.
But
throw it down, Moses. Well, Moses threw the rod on the ground, and the rod became a hissing snake. Well, Moses started running, I bet you'd run. I know I'd run. He was a running from a hot rod, running from a hissing snake, running scared of what God's gonna do, running scared he'd get a hold of you. And the Lord said, stop. Got the whole thing wrong. Don't you know that you never pick up a hissing snake by its pick it up, Moses? Lord. It's a rod again. It's a rod again. It's a rod again. Do you know what it means, Moses? Do you know what I'm trying to say, Moses? The rod of Moses became the rod of God. With the rod of God, strike the rock and the waters will come. Of the sea, with the rod of God, you can strike old Pharaoh dead. With the rod of God, you can set the people. What do you hold in your hands today? To what or to whom are you bound? Are you willing to give? Give it up, let it go, throw it down. Yeah.
because we began the new year in January, we passed out our reading that we're going to be reading through as a church. And as you opened them up, you saw that we were going to be reading through the Old Testament. And I know some of you, you don't have to be that spiritual this morning, but the truth is, many of you, when you opened that up, you said, oh, no. We're going to be going a year through the Old Testament. Man, we're going to have to get into the begats, all the names that we can't even say, and we stammer over trying to do that. Man, I want to get in the New Testament, because it's in the New Testament, man, that we find the excitement of the risen Lord. We find Jesus. But I want you to know, in our study of the Old Testament, man, it's been anything but dry and boring, amen? And you know what? We've already found Jesus in our study together. You found him in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, what is called the proto-evangelium, which is speaking of the fact that Satan would bruise Christ, or he would, in a sense, harm Christ on the hill. But Jesus, through the cross, would get the final victory over Satan. We also found that Jacob had that dream where he saw angels going up and down that ladder. But in John chapter 1, verse 51, Jesus said, I am that ladder. I am the link between earth and a holy God. I am the only way that a man can have a relationship with God. And then we came to Joseph. And we read about Joseph when we find almost in every aspect of Joseph's life, it was a prototype of what Jesus would look like and become. And so we saw Jesus in his life as well. And then we're going to see in the book of Numbers as we get there that we find that Moses is holding a rod up with a serpent on it. And all that would look towards that rod would live and not die. And we're going to see that when Jesus is lifted up, that all men will be drawn to him, and whoever places their faith in him will not die as well. And then last week, we saw about the rock, that Moses struck the rock, and Paul says, that's not any old kind of rock that Moses struck. That rock was Jesus Christ that followed the children of Israel in the wilderness. It was Christ. And today, we're going to be introduced to the tabernacle. And as we are introduced to the tabernacle, we're going to see the glorious, undisputed King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're going to encounter Jesus Christ. So take your Bibles and look with me in Exodus chapter 25, and we're going to begin in verse 1. Exodus chapter 25, beginning in verse 1, that we are going to see Jesus again in the Old Testament. Notice what it says as you read in your own translation. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and saying, tell the sons of Israel to rise and make a contribution for me. For every man whose heart, notice, whose heart moves him shall raise my contribution. And this is the contribution which you are to raise for them: gold and silver and bronze, blue and purple and scarlet materials, fine linens, goat hair, ram skin dyed red, porpoise skins, and acacia wood, oil for lighting spices, for anointing oil, for the fragrance incense, onyx stones, setting stones, and for the ephod and for the breastplate. Let them be construct a sanctuary for me, that I may dwell among them, according to all that I'm going to show you, and the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all its furniture, just so you shall construct it. This is the first time in all Scripture that God is asking for an offering. And God is saying, we're going to take an offering. The first time that we find that is happening, but notice what he's asking for: those whose hearts are willing. That carries on in the New Testament, doesn't it? In 2 Corinthians 9, 6 and 7, it tells us, let us not give what? Grudgingly or out of necessity. For God loves what? An hysterical giver. God loves those who want to give. And so what God is saying to Moses, tell the people that do not want to give, don't give. Man, we want people that want to give because their hearts are in tune to God, that love the Lord and love this tabernacle that the Lord is going to give. And the people gave. Matter of fact, later you're going to be reading that Moses had to tell the people, stop. As a Baptist preacher, I long for that day to come. Amen. Man, I long for that day to come that we would have to say, no more. And you long for it too. Amen. And for it to come. But Moses told the people, said, hey, man, we've got enough. Stop. You've been so generous. We've got all that we need. And they began to construct and make what would become the tabernacle that we're going to see today. It's a very interesting place of worship. It's 75 feet by 100 feet, and it was surrounded by curtains 7.5 feet tall that somebody couldn't just peer in. The front door or the front curtain of it is 30 feet wide. This morning that we're going to see that the tabernacle is only a shadow. Because we read in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5, we find the tabernacle is called the shadow of things to come. It's a shadow that we're going to find of the Lord Jesus Christ that is going to come and be a part. So we're going to look at the furnishings together, if we would. The first thing we're going to see is that brazen altar. And it pictures Christ as our sacrifice. If we were going to go to the temple and worship, we would go through that opening one-way door that would lead in to the tabernacle. And the largest piece of furniture that is there is the altar. The altar is 7.5 feet on all four sides, and the depth of it is 4.5 feet. And so it stood there with four horns coming out of it, like the picture that you see, and with the pose for carrying it. This large and posing thing stood there for all to see, as saying, hey, you must have a blood sacrifice to worship God. That altar was really a signpost of saying, stop, stop, no further. Don't you think that you can rush in here and come into the presence of God without giving a sacrifice for God? For don't you know who you are? Don't you understand your very nature that you're a sinful man, a sinful woman, a sinful student? You can't come before a holy and a righteous God in your sin. It takes a blood sacrifice. So you're to take a lamb, a year old, and the worshiper was to take that lamb. And we discussed that lamb quite a bit as we looked at another sacrifice, the Passover. But the worshiper is to take the lamb and he is to lay his hands on the lamb, symbolic of the fact that you're transferring your sins onto this animal. And then the priest will come and slay the lamb, and his blood would flow, and they would place him upon the altar there. And as he's placed upon the altar, we find that your sins would be covered over. Listen, it did not forgive, it didn't deal with the sin problem, but the sacrifice covered over our sins. But there's one thing that we find that was different in the Old Testament. Not only were our sins just covered over, we were still left in the guilt of our own conscience. We still were aware in our mind how sinful we were. We were still left with our conscience convicting us that, man, we are a sinner before God. And it never did anything for that. But that altar is only a reminder, as Hebrews says, of a shadow of things to come. That we find that Jesus Christ would go to the cross, that altar for us, and He would shed his blood for us. He would be truly the Lamb of God that would die for us. And as he would shed his blood for us, he became the only way to have a relationship with the Heavenly Father. Peter says it this way, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of the life inherited from your forefathers, but with the precious blood as a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Jesus. Hebrews says, how much more will the blood of Christ, through the external spirit, offered himself without blemish to God, cleanses our conscience from the dead works to serve a living Christ. You see the difference between the Old and the New Testament. When Christ died and we receive his sacrifice in our lives, his blood doesn't cover our sins. His blood removes our sin as far as the east from the west. And not only that, he cleanses our conscience, that we don't have to go around always living and being beat up by our past sins in our life, our current sins of always living in guilt, always living in discouragement in our life. When Christ forgives and moves in our life, man, he removes that and sets us free to be able to worship and enjoy him by the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the sacrifice for our sins. I want to ask you this morning, have you met him at the altar? Have you met Christ at the altar of the cross? Have you received him in your life? My friend, I want to assure you, no matter what you have accomplished in this life, no matter how many awards, how many applause that you received, how much people talk about you, my friend, it'll never get you into the presence of God. Only the blood of Jesus Christ coming into your life by you receiving his sacrifice will only be enough to allow you to come into the presence of a holy, holy God. But then we look into that tabernacle, and behind the altar we find what is there, the bronze laver. And the bronze laver pictures Christ as our sanctification. Just as behind the altar, we find that laver was there, and it was filled with water. And what is interesting about it is it was made from the maras that women donated, gave to Moses. And so the indication is that this laver had a reflection about it, and only the priests could go there. And after they would give a sacrifice, they would wash themselves, and before they would give a sacrifice. And maybe that reflection would reflect off and show them the dirt, show them the grime that was on their hands. And they would wash again to get clean in order that they might offer a sacrifice to God. You see, they had to be clean. They had to be washed before they came to the Lord. But my friend, here's what happens after we meet Christ at the altar of the cross. What begins to happen in our lives is that the Lord begins to cleanse our life. We use the word sanctified our lives, grow us in the sainthood of Christ, that we become more like him every year. You see, this is a different congregation that was a year ago. Here's what I know, that you are more like Christ today than you were a year ago, because you have grown in Christ. If you're seeking him in your life, he is sanctifying you, he is growing you, and you look more like Jesus. Dean and I had this friend that we went to church. She became a dear friend, but this is so terrible what I'm going to say, but I'm going to say it. When we first met her, our thoughts were, boy, she's not outwardly attractive at all. You know, we guess your first impression. But I'm telling you, she became one of our closest friends in our lives. And man, when we would see her, when we would encounter her, what we would see was simply Jesus. I mean, man, she was beautiful on the inside. And every time we would see her, our first impression, man, it was wiped away. What we saw in her was Jesus. And that's what happens to each of our lives as we're growing in the Lord. The Lord begins to wash us. He begins to wash us in that laver. He begins through this Holy Spirit to grow us to look more like Him. One of my favorite verses is 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10. Listen to what it says. Or do you not know that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? And do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor adulterers or adulterers, nor effeminate or homosexuals, nor thieves or covetous or drunkards or revilers or swindlers shall inherit the kingdom of God. And so Paul lays it out and said, man, these are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And then he says, and such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of God. What is Paul saying? Look, man, you were a pretty rough bunch. And some of you could stand today, and we won't get too personal today, but some of you were a pretty rough bunch, amen? But the Lord, what did He do? He saved you at the altar, and then He began to want to sanctify you. He began to sanctify you and to wash you and clean you. Titus 3:5 says, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Ghost, the Lord is changing you from glory to glory, changing you from glory to glory that you look more like Him. One of the men I serve with on the IMB is pastoring in Las Vegas. And I rode with him back to the airport, and he was telling me a story. He said, man, one of the men in our church, he said he was been in Las Vegas for just umpteen many years. He said he knew all the stars, Frank Sinatra, all the people that used to come to Vegas. He knew them. He worked at the casinos. And he said this guy had an incredible history about him. But also he had an incredible mouth, too. He said it was like a sailor that would come out in him. But he said, man, I got a privilege to lead him to Christ. And man, he got saved. And he said, man, it just changed his life. He said, man, he's at the prayer breakfasts. He's at the different things that we have at church. But he said, every once in a while, we'll be at a deal. And man, he'll let a word out. And he said, inside, I just smile. Because I know that God is doing a work in his life, cleaning him, sanctifying him day by day. He's more like Jesus. Aren't you glad that God hadn't forgot about you? It wasn't just about salvation. Oh, that's important. I wouldn't say it's not. But not only did he save you, my friend, man, he is working in your life to sanctify you, to grow you up in him, that you look more like him. Oh, we've seen Jesus all over this tabernacle. But also, I want you to know, when you walk through the next curtain, which is called the tabernacle proper, when you walk through the next curtain, out of the courtyard, when you walk in right to your right, you're going to see a table of bread. And the table of bread pictures Christ as our supplier. We find as you enter in, it's on your right-hand side. And there's a table sitting there, and there are 12 loaves of bread there. More pancake shape, flat. 6 in one plate that is gold. 6 in another plate that is gold. Symbolic of the tribes of Israel. Picturing of that bread being there, picturing God's faithfulness to the covenant. That God was saying that to Israel, I'm going to be faithful to the covenant. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to meet with you. I'm going to minister to you. I'm going to be there for you. I am going to supply whatever needs that you would ever have in your life because I am the God that loves you. But isn't that picture for us who Jesus is? Jesus said in John 6:35, I am the bread of life. And then Jesus said in John 6:51, I'm the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread also which I will give you is for this life, and the world is my flesh. It is Christ who nourishes us. It's Christ who supplies what we need. Paul writes and he says that Christ, he is the one that meets our needs. He is the one that supplies what we need. The psalmist said it so well in Psalms 23:1. The Lord is my shepherd. Say it with me. I shall not want. Say it with me again. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. Haven't you found that to be true in your own life? The Lord is the one that supplies your needs. Maybe for some of you, remember financially, you said, man, this is it. We're going under. And man, God would supply that check. Somebody would come by and bring groceries. Maybe it was a health issue in your life, and you didn't see any way out, nor did the doctor. And God supplied and met your need. But aren't you glad in your life that Jesus is there every day for us to find nourishment from? The psalmist says, taste and see that the Lord, He is good. How many would testify today and say, amen, the Lord is good? Man, He meets our needs in our life. As you walk through that curtain on the right, there's a table of bread set before you, but on your left is a beautiful candlestick. And the candlestick pictures Christ, our light. When you go into the tabernacle and through the tabernacle door and behind the curtain, we find there is no light from outside at all. There's only one light, and it's that candlestick that is burning there. Only one light. It's made of pure hammered gold. There's a center shaft, and outside that shaft comes three branches to the left, three branches to the right, and at the top, they're shaped like flowers, and inside, there's oil there with a wick, and it burns continuously before the Lord. The high priest had to come and minister before it to make sure that everything is burning, everything is lit, everything is taken care of. It's only the light in that dark, dark room. But we find in this world, in this dark world that we live in, I remember the day when there was a school shooting, the world would come to a stop. The world. Now it's an everyday occurrence almost. We hear about it almost every month, and we just keep living our lives. We live in a dark, dark world. But Jesus says, I am the light of the world. I'm the light of the world. And then He says later that you are the light of the world. And all across the city, whatever address that you would claim is your own, there is a light, there's 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 a light all across the city, because Christ has put His light in your life. And we find that in this world, there's only one light that is burning. Only one light that is burning, crying out and bringing hope to a lost world. And that is the light of Jesus Christ, as He lights to a darkened world to say, come to me, come to me. But your light, you're like poking holes in the darkness. Wherever you go, wherever you encounter somebody, you're poking holes in the darkness, showing them the light of Christ in this world. What have we seen so far in our tour of the tabernacle? That Christ is our sacrifice, that Christ is our sanctification, Christ is our supplier, and Christ is our light. But also we find in the very back, before another curtain, there sits an altar. It's the altar of incense, and it pictures Christ as our supplication. And when you walk in behind the curtains on your right side, you see the table of bread. On your left, you see this big, beautiful seven-tier candle that is burning, of lights that are burning. But when you look in the back of the room, there is an altar there. It's called the altar of incense. The priests go in twice a day. They go in the morning, they go in at twilight, and they burn frankincense to the Lord. And it's a very special aroma that they burn. No other ingredient can be added except what the Lord has instructed the priests to burn. And then once a year, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest comes to that altar and he sprinkles blood on that altar to cleanse it. What is significant about this aroma going up to heaven? Many times in the Bible we find that it's a picture of prayers being lifted to the Lord. Listen to what David said. David prayed, "May my prayers be set before you like incense." And then John writes in the book of Revelations as he sees the elders around the throne and around the golden bowls full of incense, and it says they are the prayers of God's people. But what we find is that the Bible tells us that Christ is praying for you. Listen to what it said. That Jesus Christ, the high priest, is praying for you. In Hebrews 7:25, it says, "Since he always lives to make intercession for them." Them are the saints. It's you. Can you imagine that right now, that Jesus is crying your name out to the Father? He's praying for you, praying for your strength, praying for your holiness, praying for your growth, praying for your witness in this world, praying that you would be filled with His Spirit, that Jesus Christ is making intercession for you. I get a little moved by that old country and western song. Something goes like this. Somebody's praying for you today. I love to hear that song. I hear it at funerals many times, and it always touches me to think that in this world that somebody is praying for you. This week, I met Pam in the most unusual place. I met Pam in a doctor's office. I didn't want to be there. It's freaking me out. They were talking about doing a biopsy on my neck and my thyroid area. But I came across Pam, and Pam handed me a card. And I opened that card up. It was the most beautiful written card I think maybe I've ever received. It was beautiful. Just the words that she said, what she said about the Lord, about my life. Man, it touched me greatly to know that somebody cares for you. In a time of need in your life, a time of a bump in the road, that somebody would hand you a card and say, "Man, I want you to know that, man, I love you in Christ." Man, it meant everything to me. But can you imagine that Jesus Christ loves you enough that right now He is calling your name to the Father, lifting your name up to the Father, calling out to the Father with your name? I'm telling you, that'll humble you. That'll humble you to think that He loves you that much. But we get through that room and there's one more curtain. It's blocking your view. You can't see what is behind that curtain until you open it up. And as you go in, what do you find? The Holy of Holies is a picture of Christ, our sufficiency. And as you walk in, you see the Ark of the Covenant, not like you've seen on the shows, Raiders of the Lost Ark. No. It's the Ark of the Covenant is there. And inside the Ark of the Covenant are the Ten Commandments. And there's a jar of manna sitting there reminding of God's goodness to the people. And there's Aaron's rod reminding them who is the leaders. And then on the lid of the Ark of the Covenant are two cherubim, two angels. And their wings are spread forward to overshadow that Ark of the Covenant. And there it is called in the middle, the mercy seat. It's where God said that I will meet with you. It's where I will dwell. You understand not that wasn't God's only place that you could find God, right? No place can hold God. But God said to the people that you can find me there, that I will be there. In one time of year, only one time, one man, listen to that. One time a year, one man could go behind the curtain and he would take the blood of a lamb and he would sprinkle it there on the mercy seat. Because we all need the mercy of God, don't we? He would sprinkle it there on the mercy seat in order that the people would have the mercy of God that would overshadow their lives and be given to them. But we read in the Bible, on that fateful day in which Christ died on the cross, the veil that kept us out of the presence of God, it was rent. It was rent wide open in order that all who are believers who have come under the sacrifice of Jesus Christ can come in to the presence of God. Not once a year. Not once a day. But we can stay as long as we want. And that is why it says in the Word of God, come boldly, not in an arrogant fashion that I'm going to march in before God. But I can come with that confidence in my life because why? God's mercy has been poured out to me because of the blood of Jesus Christ that I might come in His presence. In our family, if we're trying to eat, you want to be careful who you ask to pray. We usually go around the room and pick out, Hayden, will you pray? No, I don't want to pray. Yeah, you're going to pray. Why not? We're not going to eat. You're going to pray. Do you understand me? Okay. But when you call out and ask Deanne to pray, I'm telling you, your food is cold. She's praying the phone book. And here's what she does. If I pray, you know, I'll say something like this, like, Lord, protect Mike Tibbetts as he goes to Dallas this afternoon. Well, not only Mike we need to pray for, that we also need to pray. She just starts going in a litany of prayers. But isn't it the joy that we have whenever we want to, we can come into His presence. And not only can we come into His presence, we are welcomed. We are welcome to come in His presence because there you find mercy by the blood of the Lamb. And what does that symbolize for us? It's the sufficiency of the Lord. When He died for us there, and we come into that Holy of Holies, we find that all the demand of the law has been paid for in full. There's nothing else that is needed. Your relationship with the Lord and what He's done, it's sufficient. You don't have to go before Him and say, oh, I forgot to do that. There's one more thing that I must do. No. Everything that is needed for you to have a relationship with Him for all eternity has been paid for. The sufficiency of what Christ has done. No need for a priest. No need for a man-made religion. No need for anything. Christ made it, paid it all. The sufficiency of Christ for you to go before Him. My friend, before you even can go into the tabernacle, you've got to go through the tribe of Judah, don't you? The tribe of Judah camped outside. And so we got to go through the tribe of Judah. Who do we find came from the tribe of Judah? Say it with me, Jesus. And then before you can go in, you've got to go through one curtain. There's not different entrances into the tabernacle. There's only one. And we find that Jesus Christ is the only way to have a relationship with the Heavenly Father. And when you get into the temple, what do you find? Man, you're bumping into Jesus everywhere into that temple. So I want to ask you today, have you met Jesus as your sacrifice for your sins? Have you met him at the altar of the cross and you said, Lord, I accept what you have done for my sins. It's the only payment. It's the only way. Lord, I receive it. And then have you met him at the altar of sanctification? See, the Lord's working in your life, but some of you are harder to work in than others. Somebody say amen. It's a lot easier when you have a humble heart kneeling before an open Bible and saying, God, your will, your way in my life. Are you yielding, bending your will to the sanctification of the Lord? Are you grateful that God is meeting your needs in your life, supplying for you whatever that you need for this day? This day. Is he your light? Have you found him as your light in this dark world? Have you found him as your hope? And then, my friend, are you awed by the fact that he is praying for you? When you don't even know how to pray, remember the Holy Spirit gives you the words? And Jesus is calling your name. Are you grateful for the sufficiency of Christ, or are you trying to get on that treadmill and say, you know what? If I do this, he'll love me. If I accomplish this, he'll love me. If I read through the reading plan this year, he'll really love me. Or do you understand? He's already paid it all. Nothing you can do more today will cause him to love you more than he already does. You see, the tabernacle is a shadow of the one that would come. And he did come. And the Bible says he tabernacled among us. As your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, have you met him? Have you met him in that tabernacle? If you're here today and you've never given your heart to Christ, listen, my friend, you can receive Christ today and you can know that you know that you know that you can come in his presence. You can know that you will enter into heaven, not because you're a good person or you were raised by a good family, but you can know that you know that because of what Jesus Christ has done. Do you know him as your sanctifier? Do you know him as your supplier? Do you know him as your light? The one that is praying for you? Do you know him as your sufficiency? My friend, you can today because he paid it all.
Extended and of God's faithfulness through it all. Despite humanity's rebellion and disobedience, God's plan to set things right kept unfolding. There were times the Almighty's voice thundered with judgment. Sometimes it was a song of comfort. For 400 years, he was simply silent. Then one night, in the town of Bethlehem, everything changed.
Hallelujah.
as a boy, Jesus roamed the hills of Nazareth. At 12, he stood in the temple and spoke of tending to his father's business. At 30, he was baptized as John proclaimed him the Lamb of God. Then for 3 years, he traveled throughout the land, healing the sick, delivering the broken, loving the outcast, and even raising the dead. At last, the road turned again to Jerusalem as he rode into the city. Crowds greeted him the way they should greet a conquering king. As the journey had taken thousands of years, descended into deep shadows. Powerful religious and political forces aligned to destroy him. One who had posed as a faithful follower betrayed him for the price of a slave. But first the Lord would eat the Passover meal with his friends. He had more opportunity to show them his love, preparing them for the coming day. In Gethsemane, Jesus prayed alone. The first drops of blood that he would shed on our behalf trickled down his brow as he surrendered to his Father's will. Soldiers arrived to arrest him, and the long night of trial and torture began. He was stripped and scourged and mocked. And then he carried his own cross up the hill of Golgotha, where he opened his arms, submitted to the nails in his hands and feet, and laid down his wife willingly in your place and mine.